Hey everybody, Daren Millard, welcoming you back to the Chirp. YouTube and audio versions are both available this week. Wasn't sure because for the first time, we had a guest zoom in from a highway rest stop. It's true. It happened this week. And that deserves a like or a rating or a subscription, something, because the sacrifices and the commitment by the guests to the Chirp podcast is like no other podcast that I know of. Ken Morrow won 4 Stanley Cups on the heel of the Miracle on Ice with Team USA in Lake Placid. He joins us. Brad Park is a Hockey Hall of Famer, top 100 players of all time. He will also stop by and they will be on the Chirp podcast together. So the sort of genesis of this week's episode is this. This postseason involves a couple of rivalries that we haven't seen in a while. Montreal, Toronto, 1979. Boston and the New York Islanders, first time since the mid to early 80s. And we connect with a couple of blue liners for their memories from the last encounter between the Islanders and Boston. 1983, a 6-game series win for Al Arbour and the Islanders. In front of a jam-packed house in both the Boston Garden and the Nassau Coliseum. And Brad Park was a veteran on that Boston Bruin team. And we had Ken Morrow, who was cutting his teeth, really coming into his own as a blue liner for the New York Islanders. It was the final title in the dynasty of the New York Islanders. There's just so many storylines to talk about between these two as Park and Morrow swap stories. So we've got old buildings. We've got big beards with the New York Islanders. And we've got physical hockey with a ton of goals. A half dozen Hall of Famers played in the series. The coaches are both Hall of Famers. Jerry Cheevers as a player, but Al Arbour as a coach. And Morrow and Park patrolled their respective blue lines in that set. And today, they exchange just pure respect. It's a great episode of The Chirp with Daren Millard. So settle in for an incredible conversation. So talking to these great defensemen, Ken Morrow and Brad Park, how much do you guys know each other, having faced each other but a long time ago? I'm just curious about your relationship. Brad.
Yeah, I don't think I've seen Ken in 20 years. I think a couple of old-timer events, that's about it. But, we kind of live in different parts of the country.
Yes. Yeah. I think the last time I saw Brad was in, I want to say, the press box. You might have been doing some scouting at that time up in Manchester. Yeah. And that may be the last time that I can remember anyway.
How are the knees, Ken?
For me, everything's great. I just had knee replacement. I just passed my 1-year anniversary for having my my right knee replaced, and like everybody else my age, I think it's pretty common for people to have it done, and everything's fantastic. Thanks for asking.
That's great. How about you, Brad? How are you doing?
I had both knees replaced in 2007, so I got steel knees, right? And the good news is I can golf 8 days in a row. But I don't have the heart to tell my wife.
So let's go back to 1983. And I can't believe, first of all, that the Bruins and the Islanders just playing for the third time ever. Who is the favorite going into that series? And Brad, I'll start with you because you guys were in Boston, the President's Trophy winners, but the Islanders, 3-time Stanley Cup champions. Who had the edge going in?
I think that the Islanders being, coming off winning 3 Stanley Cups is, a formidable opponent. We were a younger team. We had actually met 3 years prior, 1980, in a fisticuff series. There was a lot of things like that. And that they beat us and they went on to win the Stanley Cup that year. I think that at that point, they went into this, having this nucleus of players that was so good and so talented, I would have looked at them as being the favorites, even though we had had a terrific year.
Ken, did you feel the same way?
Well, I don't know that we were favorites. I never felt that way, even through all those you know, those great years that we had in the early 80s. But I never went into a series feeling comfortable that, you know, we were going to win. As Brad mentioned, they had just some fantastic teams and still do to this day. But, you know, they were that one organization along with a couple others, you know, Philadelphia and ourselves, that always seemed to put really good teams out every year. And that 1980 series, as Brad mentioned, that really was what got us over the hump, I would say, as far as just having to persevere and battle through and really earn your way to a Stanley Cup. And then in 1983, they had a tremendous regular season. They were the top seed going into the playoffs. They still had, you know, some veteran players like Brad and just some great players, legends. But they had some new kids in there with Gord Kluzak and Peterson. So they had a nice combination of young and veteran. And boy, we knew it was going to be a tough series, and it was.
Ken, what was the strategy going into that set?
Well, our strategy, I mean, you know, I know the one thing I do remember, and I, you know, my memory's not great. It's been a long time ago, but what I do remember everybody talking about, or the media talking about anyway, was that Luke Dufour was going to shadow Mike Bossy that series. And I think Mike even got asked about that after the series. And, you know, that was kind of a big thing back then, as teams sometimes would put a shadow on a guy, you know, trying to shut down a player like a Mike Bossy. But the series ended up to be a high scoring series. There were a lot of high scoring games that series. It just kind of took on a life of its own from what I remember.
Do you remember that, Brad?
Well, I know that the Cheesy was a big guy who's coaching us, was a big believer of a shadow. You know, he'd put Stevie Casper on Gretzky, and if Gretzky went to Dunkin' Donuts, Stevie would be there ordering for him. and I'm sure that he was looking at putting Luke Dufour on there. But, you know, looking back, and I recounted, I said, you know, we were a younger team. And I went and I looked up the lineups, and we had 11 guys that were 22 or younger. And the Islanders had three that were 22 or younger. So there was a big difference in experience. And then I went in and I looked, well, what about 25 to 30, which guys in their prime? And I said, okay, they had, I think, 11 guys, and we had five guys. So it was a big, yeah, it was a big difference in their experience and, you know, their offensive abilities, you know, with, you know, good centers down, you know, with Trotz and Goring and Sutter, and you know, they just kept coming after you. You know, Wayne Merrick was a great defensive guy, big in size. So their strength was down the middle. And then, you know, what's to say about Mike Bossy? You know.
Yeah.
He could put it in a hole from 55 feet.
Yeah, Brad brought up a great point, and I didn't realize the age difference there. But, you know, they had some terrific young players. Ray Bork was a young guy at that time. And as I mentioned, Kluzak and Peterson and some other players. And we had what ended up to be 16 guys that played on all four Stanley Cup teams. So that would have been right in the prime or toward the later part of all those guys' careers at that time.
So, Brad, when you look back, what was the difference in the series? It was a six-game series, and Kenny mentioned it was high scoring. There was a lot of blowouts both ways.
Yeah, I think that, you know, there was a couple of games that we got beat handily in the first game, came back and beat them handily in the second game, and then we went to the island, and that's where it got really difficult, and, you know, they just kind of took control in their own building, and it was very hard. And the one thing I think Pete Peters, who had a great year, you know, he was just taking a barrage of shots from everywhere and screens and deflections. So you know, Pete was that was something he didn't see all season long, but getting that game after game was pretty hard on us.
Kenny?
Yeah, I'm not proud to say as a defenseman, you know, you're not proud to say you took part in a series like that where there were 8 goals scored, 7 goals scored, and you know, going both ways. So it just happened to be, as I said, sometimes the series do take on a life of their own, whether they're tight checking all the way through or for whatever reason, wide open. And these were two teams that generally played pretty good defensive hockey, but it just opened up that series for whatever reason. And then, as I mentioned, Mike Bossy, I think he ended up scoring 9 goals in that series. He had a hat trick one game, 4 goals another. So it just, you know, and they were scoring on us as well. So it was an interesting series in that regard.
Interesting coaching matchup too, Brad, but anything you want to chime in there on what Kenny just had?
Yeah, I think what happened during the year, I think the Islanders were number one in goals against, and we were number two. So both teams could play defense. And that went out the window early because, a team would jump up to a 2-goal lead, and then it would just start to open up. And once it started to open up, it was going in both directions. And, as much as you wanted to not backpedal, you were backpedaling.
What was the style of hockey like? And we'll compare it a little bit to what we see today. Like, how would you describe what you went through because of all the goals, but then there was still some physical element to it, Brett?
I think that the style was that both teams would be coming up the ice more with east-west passing than north-south passing. It wasn't any long stretch passing. You know, the red line was in play. Guys would be getting into the holes and they'd get the puck and they knew exactly where the next guy was going to be. And that was the style that both teams played. It wasn't where you went for the long pass and dumped it in. It was, you wanted to hit the blue line with the puck going east-west and hit it with some speed and numbers.
Kenny?
Yeah, I mean, even from what I remember, going back to those days, you had the red line in, so you would think that would have slowed the game down. Playing in the old Boston Garden, the tight checking, that would have slowed the game down. For whatever reason, it was a fairly wide open series. And I think it was a lot of it could be attributed just to the talent, the offensive talent that was on both of those teams. And as I said, as a defenseman, sometimes as hard as you try, you get into those kind of games. And that's the way I remember that series being. There wasn't, I don't know, one game that you could say was a real tight checking one goal game.
You brought up the building, so let's go there. Ken, Boston Garden and Nassau Coliseum, different and one still in existence, which is hard to believe. But take us through that.
Well, I mean, Boston Garden, no secret, it was an intimidating building to play in, and their teams were built around that building, and I remember my defense partner, Gordy Lane, talking about, he used to say, after a game in Boston Gardens, he'd come away and he said his toes were sore because he was always going back into the corner and getting smashed into the glass, when you're going back for the puck. So, it wasn't a fun place to play, I can tell you that. There just wasn't any room out there. And then Nassau Coliseum, obviously, we called Fort Never Lose, and I just think both buildings had an intimidating factor to them.
Brad?
I think both buildings, when you walked into the Boston, there's a number of buildings around the league that when you walked in, there was a buzz of excitement, and you could feel the vibration when you walked in, and the Islanders were on a roll in those years. You could feel that vibration that's going to be there. And the Boston Garden, and when you walked into those buildings, the first thing you said to yourself was, boy, it's going to be a hootenanny tonight, because you don't know what's going to happen, but it's going to be entertaining.
Did you hate playing at Coliseum, Brad?
No, I liked it. I loved getting called all kinds of names and things like that. So it was, I love playing in Nassau. Hell, I was with the Rangers for a number of years, and you know, we lived in Long Beach, which wasn't a far ride from there. So, you know, going into that building, it was great. You went in underground, you went right into your dressing room, and you knew the people were going to be, you know, as New York fans are, you know, a little hyper, and they were going to be hyper, and they're going to be into it. And the Boston Garden was another building, because the smallness of the building, because the fans, with the balconies going straight up, the fans are right over you, and they were right there. They get to see the sweat fall off your nose.
You're right, and we watch the Coliseum games now, and we realize how intimate it is, and the Boston Garden was even closer. So Kenny, you wouldn't have known any different, right? That's just the way you played. But looking at today's building, it feels like the fans are miles away.
You're right, and it's incredible, the difference. And boy, I miss those old buildings. You know, as tough as they were to play in, you really miss them, because I remember my memories of a lot of these buildings. You'd walk in and the smell would tell you right away where you were. I remember Boston Garden, you could smell the popcorn. And, you know, you'd go into Toronto Maple Leaf Gardens and it had a certain smell to it, a hockey smell, I want to say. Mm-hmm. And then, as you mentioned, the fans being right on top of you, sometimes you felt like they were sitting on your bench with you, you know, in Boston. And so it just all added to the atmosphere. And boy, you sure miss that. I mean, they, you know, the amenities and the luxuries they have nowadays are second to none, but boy, you miss those old arenas, and the Coliseum is still there for now.
Brad, what did the Coliseum smell like?
You know, I never really even thought about that. You know? I figured I wanted to be close to the guys I played against to see what they smelled like. You know, the guys that were into the garlic. You know, the guys that were into the garlic real quick.
And well, I do remember going into Madison Square Garden in the springtime when they had the circus in town. And boy, mm-hmm. It smelled like animals. Yeah, for sure.
That I've heard before. Elephant.
You can smell the elephants, yes.
Brad, what was it like playing somebody like Billy Smith and going up against a guy that was so physical and so intense?
Well, I really, as a defenseman, you know, on occasion I'd be around Billy, but generally speaking, it was, you know, the forwards had to deal with him more than I did. Right. And so Billy never bothered me other than he kept stopping the puck. But one thing about Billy, if he could see it, you weren't going to beat him. And he was going to keep his crease clear, and which would cut down on any screenshots, things like that. So and Billy wasn't really a guy that would come out and handle the puck a lot. He would on occasion, but it wasn't something that he would regularly do. So, which, you know, Kenny would be going back for the puck and Billy would stop it for him. But, you know, he wasn't going to be stick handling out there. I mean, he was good with the stick, but not with the puck.
Yeah, I get what you mean there. Kenny, what was it like being a defenseman with Battling Billy?
Well, as Brad said, if Billy came out of the net, it wasn't to play the puck, it was to take the body. So I don't know that there's a more fierce competitor. I know certainly for goaltenders and probably in the whole league, he was as fierce a competitor as you'd ever see. And so, you know, I tell people, you know, his own defensemen, which would be me and Dennis and everybody else, you know, we were the collateral damage of the stick work he did in front of the net. And yeah, and then, you know, there was always that time when the game would be going along fairly smoothly, and just out of the blue, Billy would have to do something to kind of stir things up and get the other team going. So, you know, he had that knack of, you know, all of a sudden, there'd have to be a several scrums around the net, you know, just when you thought things were going fairly smoothly. So, love the guy, love playing in front of him. There wasn't a more fierce competitor on the ice.
Who were you focused on stopping, Ken, in that series?
Well, Gosh. Well, as I mentioned, you know, I think the Barry Peterson line was the top line for them at that year. But, you know, Peter McNabb, Rick Middleton, you know, I know he's got a nickname. I can't think of what it is, but he had some of the slickest hands. Yeah. And so as a defenseman, he was a nightmare to play against because you thought you had him and then he'd do a little dipsy doodle or something. He'd be by you. So they had, yeah, they certainly had some weapons. And then they had the Crowder brothers who not only scored, but they liked to mix it up. We had the Sutter brothers and they had the Crowder brothers.
So. what was the nickname, Brad?
He was called Nifty.
Nifty. You know.
There's three guys that as a defenseman, that one-on-one, I would have to be very careful with over the years. He was one. Yes. I mean, I'd go to practice and we'd do one-on-ones and I'd always find that I was the first one in line because none of the other defensemen wanted to take him. The other two guys would be Gilbert Perreault and Mario Lemieux. I think in the history of the game, those are the three most dangerous guys that could turn the inside out.
So Bossy was a different type of performer. What was your game plan against him, Brad?
Well, I was a right defenseman and he was a right winger, so I didn't see him a lot. Mm-hmm. Right? But I think the key to Mike was that, you know, if you look at a lot of the great centers in the game, the great tandem duels, twosomes, you know, you had Lemaire Lafleur, left-hand center, right-hand shooter. Sidler McDonald, left-hand center, right-hand shooter. Rattel Gilbert, left-hand center, right-hand shooter. Bossy Trottier, left-hand center, right-hand shooter. That was Gretzky Curry, left-hand center, right-hand shooter. That shooter gets out in the deeper slot, and that left-hand center can feed him a one-timer, and he can release it. Nobody could release it any better than Mike Bossy. I mean, he could get rid of that puck in a heartbeat.
So you had a strategy. What was it, and where did it go awry?
The strategy was make sure you don't get run over by Bryan Trottier. Because he was a hard-nosed little bar, wow. Right? And you hit him, he was going to hit you back. And he was such a great playmaker. And he was actually Bossy's corner guy.
Really?
Him and Clark Gillies were Bossy's corner guy.
Clark, I get. You agree with that, Kenny?
Yeah, Brad brought up some great points. Bryan was, he wasn't tall, but he was thick. And he just had that thick body, legs, trunk, everything. And he was farm boy strong. So, you know, I don't know that he gets enough credit for the type of player he was because he scored 120 points a year, but he was every bit as good a checker and hit. And when he hit the hurt, you know, like it wasn't just to rub a guy out. So he was honest, but he was strong and determined. And some of the best body checks I've seen from when I played were thrown by Bryan Trottier. And Brad said it best, you know, Bryan and Mike Bossy were inseparable. They were joined at the hip on the ice and off the ice. And I think that just, that chemistry carried over when they were out there together. I know they talked about it, but Bryan could throw a pass without even knowing where Mike was. He'd throw the puck over there knowing that Mike was going to be there at some point. And can't tell you how many goals I saw them score that way.
Brad, that ended up being your last series or last game with the Boston Bruins. Did you think that was your best shot, last shot at a cup because you guys had such a great year?
No, I didn't. I mean, the next year I went to Detroit as a free agent. But at that time, I looked at the team that we had. As I said, it was a young team and they were going to get better. And Ray Bourque was going to get better. He was, you know, like the new Dennis Potvin, and he was going to get better. Peterson was going to get better. Everybody's going to get more experience. And I saw that team growing as it went along.
I can't believe it, but you go through the defensemen, Ken. Who's the best defenseman in that series? When you go down through the list of all the blue liners that you guys played with and that you got a chance to play against.
Well, yeah, I mean, you had Brad and you had Dennis were the two legends, basically, that, you know, that were they were in their primes or you know, right around that time. And then you had Ray Bourque on up and coming, and as I mentioned, Gord Kluzak. And so, yeah, there were some stuff. We had Stefan Persson as well. You know, you don't get that far and you don't get that good, you know, without winning the overall title that year, Boston, and with us, you know, winning those cups, you don't get that far without having some great players on the back end and some depth there as well. And I think that's what gave us a little bit of an edge, was just that we were a deep team, you know, on the back line. You know, it certainly helped carry us through some tough series.
Brad, how would you have beat the Islanders when you look back? What would have made the difference?
Well, let me just expound on what Kenny was saying. Two things that the Islanders did that solidified their defense was when Kenny came over in 1980 after the Olympics, and they acquired Gordie Lane. And Gordie Lane, when he was with Washington, before he went to the Islanders, I went to Harry and I said, look, this guy, I don't know him, but I know he doesn't back down. If you can get him, go and get him. And he ended up going to the Islanders along with Kenny and Gordy, you know, and Dennis and Pearson, and they had such a strong defense that they, you know, you weren't going to get a lot of golden opportunities. I think that what we needed was probably more experience. As I said, we were a young team. You know, we had a Randy Hillier there, Larry Melnick. They were just coming along. So I think that we just needed more experience. We needed more finish up front in order to, you know, try and score a number of goals that would have to match the Islanders.
The coaching edge, nothing against Cheesy, but boy, you go against a man that was standing behind your bench. Boy, Kenny, you guys had some real edge there.
Yeah, and how lucky was I? You know, he was when I joined the team, as Brad mentioned, right after the Olympics in 1980. You know, the Islanders had quickly become a force in the league in the late 70s, and had been through a couple of playoff disappointments. But you know, to have that rock behind the bench like Al Arbour, you know, he's right there on the Mount Rushmore of NHL coaches, as far as I'm concerned. So, yeah, and for me to have a guy that understood, he played a similar style of game that I did, you know, as a defensive defenseman. So I think it was a blessing for me just to be able to have a guy like that behind the bench that I guess I could say maybe I played somewhat of a similar style to Al. And so I think he appreciated that. I was just very fortunate in that regard.
Hey, was that the best that the Islanders played during their run? Was that playoff series or playoff year? Because you guys had some challenges and you handled them all pretty easily or efficiently.
I will say, and I know a number of the guys said this afterwards in 1983, having to get through Boston, you know, many people thought, and maybe rightfully so, that, you know, we were going to get knocked off by Boston. You know, we were going into that series maybe the underdogs because of the year that they had, and we were starting to get some injuries and missing some players in that regard. So to get through Boston and then go up against Edmonton in 83, a juggernaut at that time, a young juggernaut, you know, they looked invincible. And just the way that we were able to pull out a sweep of Edmonton, I don't know that anybody else could have done it. I think the experience, as Brad mentioned, really worked in our favor in that series. And I know a lot of our players have said that 1983, that was maybe their favorite Stanley Cup. You always remember the first one, but that was maybe by far the toughest, those last two series, and just the way that we were able to get through those.
Hey, Brad, is it hard not to be envious of a guy like Kenny walking in there off 1980 and then winning those cups?
No, it's not. I mean, I think Kenny was a big part of all four of those Stanley Cups. You know, I sit back and look at now and I'm saying, you know, I never won a Stanley Cup. And I said it wasn't in the cards. And I also realized that we just got beat by better teams. And, you know, when you can say and look at it that way and say, look, no, they were a better team and they beat us. You know, just as Montreal won four Stanley Cups in a row, they were a better team. And, you know, you look at it and you've got to give credit where credit's due.
I just can't imagine how much you, like deep down in your heart, do you dislike the New York Islanders, having been a Ranger guy and then come up against the New York Islanders twice in the playoffs? So what, if you look at that Islander logo, Brad, what do you feel?
I look at the Islander logo. I look at a 2 out of 3 series that got me. Hold on 1 second. Let me just put this on hold. I look at a 2 out of 3 series when we were supposed to beat them. And it was the last time they had a 2 out of 3 series. And after we got beat by the Islanders, they ended up dispersing all the Rangers. And that's how I ended up in Boston.
Wow. I look at, go ahead, Kenny.
It's their fault. It's their fault.
Well, I'm not going to take credit for that. But for a guy like Brad Park, he's a hero of mine. You know, he's a legend. I love the way he played the game, especially now that I've been a scout for 30 years. And I really appreciate, I don't know that there was anybody that thought the game better than he did. And that to me might be at the top of the list of, as far as things to look at it with a player. He was smooth. He was poised beyond anybody that I can remember. Still, he had just all these great qualities and then the longevity to go with it. It hurt to watch him skate at the end just with the knees. I know I had a little bit of a knee problem. I know he had a lot more than I did, and the way he made it through, I'll tell you, I'm a huge fan of Brad Park.
Well, thank you, Kenny.
That's pretty cool, Kenny.
Let's put it this way. Don't downplay yourself, because you weren't, you may have been lucky to get there, but if you weren't any good, you wouldn't have been there for four. they move people in a heartbeat. You would have been gone, yeah. But you know, you were that good player that, you know, you
stood your ground. I understand that. Thank you. Appreciate that.
I look at Kenny now and clean shaven, great shape, but like, were the Islanders the formation of the playoff beard? Because like Gordy Lane and Clark and yourself, like, is that where it started?
You know, I have to say, I've been asked this question before, and I had no clue until the great Stan Fischler wrote an article several years ago, and there's been some other historians that have given credit to those Islander teams. I think Bryan Trottier said it goes back to 75, but I think more than likely it came right that year. Clark Gillies and Dennis Podvin and I joined a team. I had a beard coming in, and they've given that team credit with starting the playoff beard, which now is carried over into baseball and some of these other sports. So who knows, but it was fun to be a part of any discussion in that regard.
Brad, did you ever grow a playoff beard? I can't remember you with one.
As a matter of fact, when I went to Detroit, they hadn't made the playoffs in 7 years. We made the playoffs the first year, and the next year we came around in January, and we're kind of up and down. We're riding this roller coaster. And I said, okay, guys, I said, we're going to grow a beard and we're going to grow it until we win 3 games in a row. And when we got to April, we had full playoff beards.
Love it.
Well, look, at least it looked good, right?
It did. We didn't get out of the first round, so we didn't have them that much longer.
Really appreciate this. I want to give an opportunity for some final thoughts to both of you and Brad. This what a treat being able to listen to you and just sharp as a tack when it comes to all these memories. Your memories, final thoughts to put a bow on those 1980s series and 1983 in particular.
I think the hockey at that time was coming into a new era. And with the likes of the Islanders, I'm going to say the Montreal 4 Stanley Cups was part of the 70s, the early years. But going into the 80s, the Islanders set the standard. And they set it, and then Edmonton carried it on. And they did it through good, solid, hard-nosed play. No intimidation of other superstars. Physically, they just played the game, played the way it was supposed to be. It was an honor to play against them. It's never an honor to lose, but it was an honor to play against them.
Kenny?
That was well said. First of all, thanks. Terrific to see Brad again. And I hope we can do more of these kind of things, because there's nothing better than sitting next to a Scotty Bowman or a Brad Park or some of these guys and hearing the hockey stories. I love it. Can't get enough of it. I think Brad said it best. You know, Montreal had their run in the late 70s. And it doesn't mean that there weren't other great teams in the league at that time. They were just that much better. I think we had our run in the early 80s, very similar in that, you know, this Boston team in 1983 was a very, very good team. And they could have easily have gone on and had a great series with Edmonton and walked away with the Stanley Cup. But that's the way it worked back then. You had these teams that were able to stay together for a number of years. You can't necessarily do that in today's environment. But Edmonton had their run after us. And I'm just thankful I was on the right side of a few of those.
And we should mention Brad and I are both in our respective offices, nice and comfortable, and enjoying this setting. And Kenny, you're somewhere on the road in your car. You can see the headrest behind you. Where are you? And just how do you get Wi-Fi wherever you are?
Okay. Here's a good one for you. I'm in Boonville, Missouri, at a rest stop. And, I'm on my way to Ohio, making a trip right now. This is about as good as it gets for me technology wise.
Who would have thought in 1983 we'd be doing this like we are right now? It's amazing, and we can thank the Boston Bruins and the New York Islanders for bringing you two together. And I love the mutual admiration, and it's pretty cool, because that was a fierce time in the National Hockey League. Brad Park, Ken Morrow, thank you very much for joining us on the Chirp with Daren Millar.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Brad Park, quick. I haven't done this every episode, but I did send a couple of texts out to people just saying, you know who I'm doing the Chirp with today? Ken Morrow and Brad Park. And to hockey people too, coaches around the National Hockey League, a couple of defensemen that I know that used to play in the NHL going, this is pretty cool. And came right back going, Brad Park, know him. Ken Morrow, what a stud. Can you imagine that guy's trophy case? And Brad Park's memory, wow. That's unbelievable. And Ken Morrow, just a commitment to getting things done. Versatile, the most versatile guest that we've ever had. And we wish them the best of luck. I'm thinking Rick Middleton, haven't heard that name in a while. Pete Peters was my idol growing up. And I remember that season when he got traded from Philadelphia over to the Boston Bruins and won that Vezina trophy. And then they stumble in the playoffs, because that looked like it was going to be Boston's year. And the playoff beards. When I think of the New York Islanders, I think big, burly men. That's what it is, like sweat dripping down their faces with those beards. I wonder, Bob Bender's the producer of the Chirp podcast. You know him. You love him. But here's the thing about Bob. Bob's you're a Long Island guy, correct?
Born and raised in Long Island, okay. Darren, yes.
So give me an idea. Now, you're younger than me, so you probably didn't watch this series or this era of hockey in the early 80s. Give me your memories of what you would reflect on with the New York Islanders in that that early 90s or early 80s team.
Well, Darren, I was born in 1983. My father moved to Long Island in, I think, 1981. And the stories growing up for me was that team was the best team that he's ever seen play. Of course, the dynasty, and would say and continues to say that that era, when they won those four cups, Long Island was alive. They loved the Islanders. There was a craziness about the Islanders that he was unfamiliar with before getting to Long Island. So to get those guys on, and it's amazing that they've only met three times in the playoffs, yeah. And that was the last time. So what, 38 years ago or so? So it was cool to kind of hear some of those stories. But as I look back, and of course, you know, I just heard the stories through, you know, my dad or my mom. My mom was born in Long Island, born and raised in Long Island. So she understands the history also of this team. And the fact that they're still playing in Nassau Coliseum certainly is a cool little nugget or feature to this.
Right. That Islanders team, that was sort of the last hurrah. They made the Stanley Cup final the next year. Won 19 series in a row, by the way. Which, what
That's
are the
never going to happen? Yeah. Never going to happen again. Sorry, but it's not.
Not a chance. Won four Stanley Cups and then went to the final the fifth year before losing to the Edmonton Oilers. 19 series in a row. That 1983 team, that was their last championship. And then they went in a different direction. And Boston was supposed to take over. And it didn't quite happen. You heard Brad talk about how young they were. That was supposed to be the escalation, and it just never quite pulled. I don't think they won another series until 1988. So it's sort of the high watermark for both teams in that mid to early 80s. And you think about some of the names out of it, and Ray Bourque was a young guy. Dennis Potvin, like we hardly. The best part about it is we hardly talked about Ray Bourque and Dennis Potvin because there's so much other stuff that went into that. I could talk about this forever, Bob, honestly. Hey,
and Mike Bossy was out of his mind in that series. And the other thing I took away from that is I pulled up an article from the New York Times previewing that series in 1983. I sent it to you.
Yep.
And some of the same storylines and things that we hear about now going into the series, you know, the rest versus rust. Boston was coming off a really hard series against Buffalo. The Islanders had 3 days of rest before that series started. And Brad Park is quoted in that New York Times article saying, you know, I'd love to have 3 days rest. You know, we just have to forget about that Buffalo series. It's over. It was a battle. We move ahead to Long Island. And the fact that they were the President's Trophy winner also, that dynamic, you know, best record, regular season going up, trying to knock down the dynasty. So that series back then had everything.
You know, I think about Mike Kelly, our buddy from the analytics field that we had on a couple of weeks ago, and how analytics may have changed that series or some of those encounters. And you think about how things were handled then with Jerry Cheevers talking about just shadowing Mike Bossy, and like the Oilers, people use that against Wayne Gretzky and company, and Steve Kasper was so good at it, and I haven't heard of that or thought of that idea in a while. It sort of came back a couple of like in spurts against Connor McDavid this year, but not to the extent that it was utilized there. And the idea when I went through that article that you sent me, previewing the series and the New York Islanders blue line. And it was dressed 6D, but one doesn't play because Dennis Potvin just rotates through. So he plays two of every three shifts. That's the way Al Arbour handled it. And no way that happens now. Not a chance that you do that unless it was like unforeseen circumstances. You may play 5D and that's happened before, but you usually kind of rotate a couple of guys through. So just having that in the Stanley Cup playoffs when attrition is such a key part and rest is such a weapon nowadays. Nope. Al Arbour just went with 5D through that whole thing. And Pete Peters against Billy Smith with the defense, were they goaltenders in that series? Two very different styles. I don't know. By the way, wanted to mention this to you. We are going to do this again, if you're okay with it. And not about the 1983 team, though. You and I, Bob, are going to get together in the year 2059. All right? Because it's 38 years since 1983. We're going to get together in the year 2059. So hold that open in your calendar. And we're going to chat with Ryan Pulock and Charlie McAvoy, if that's okay. I love that. All right? And we'll reflect. Hopefully they'll meet. Again, like two great franchises. Why? It's weird that they only played three times.
I wonder what rest stop I'll be chatting with you from. I'm not sure. I wonder where I'm going to retire. Maybe it's somewhere in Arizona. We'll find a nice special rest stop where I'll be sort of mirroring what Ken Morrow just did for us, which we really appreciate both Brad Park, Ken Morrow making it happen. You know, because if this series, if the Islanders didn't even it up, we probably wouldn't have done this. Because
right.
The series goes six or seven games. It's not really a conversation to have. So we were sort of on standby and both guys made it happen. So we appreciate it.
At a rest stop, like Ken Morrow, four-time Stanley Cup champion, miracle on ice, pulls over to the side of the road to chat with us on the Chirp. And you could feel the admiration, right? The respect and the just pure appreciation of chatting with a guy like Brad Park.
Last thing I'll say, yeah. I was talking to Ken Morrow trying to set this up, and he said, Brad Park, you're telling me I can talk with Brad Park? And he's like my idol. He's like the defenseman that I loved watching him play. No problem. We'll get it done. So the admiration, mutual admiration, definitely evident as the conversation went on. But especially when I talked to Ken before the interview, he was like, Brad Park, absolutely. I'm all in.
And while we were waiting for Kenny to get to the rest stop, I was on the Zoom with Brad Park, just shooting the breeze. He's got a lot of stuff going on. It was his idea. When you ice the puck and you're not allowed to change. That came from him originally, and then it was funneled up. So that should be called the Brad Park rule. And I'll give you one more thing that he wants to see. He would like there to be a shootout every game between the second and the third, and teams will know who won the shootout. So if the game is tied after regulation, or they know that they have to push it in overtime, one team, because they've already lost the shootout. They have to push it for the victory. The other one team can play a little bit more kitty by the door. And the best part is, between the second and third, every game you get a shootout. Every game you get a shootout. So that's I've never heard of that one.
That's an interesting little tweak or rule change that he had as we were just shooting the breeze before
shooting the breeze. The interview.
So we're gonna have to elevate that up to the hockey ops department. Maybe a potential rule change, and maybe what 2059 or whatever year.
2059. We'll be able to reflect. Do you think you'll have a flying car in 2059? Will you have to land the flying car to chat with us in 2059?
Well, I heard people say that we'd be flying cars in 2021, and that's not the case. So 2059, hopefully we can be flying around the with the cars. That would be nice. Marty McFly style.
I would just like it if the people I live with didn't leave the car on empty with the light going in 2059 when I get into it. Can I just say that? Can I just make that my goal? I hope they don't hear this.
My watch is going off. We have to put a bow on it.
All right.
We have to put a bow on it. This was fun though, Daren.
Thanks for setting that up. You are the maker of dreams for Ken Morrow and company. Bob Bender, producer of the Chirp podcast with Daren Millard. Like, subscribe, rate, do all those things. Like, Ken Morrow went to the extreme for this podcast. Please give us a rating and click that little like button if you're on YouTube at the bottom of the screen, or rate us if you're listening to this on the audio version of a podcast. Ken Morrow, Brad Park on The Chirp with Daren Millard. Only here, folks. Only right here.